This afternoon, we're just going to reflect on a few more verses in Romans chapter 12. We know that the first part of Romans, the first 11 verses, first 11 chapters deal with doctrine. As we come to Romans 12, it's dealing with application. And the last time, it talked about the gifts that are mentioned in Romans chapter 12. As you look at verse 9, it's very interesting. It says this. This is out of the Holman Christian. It says, love must be without hypocrisy. It's interesting that Paul would write that there. The actual Greek says, the love without hypocrisy. There is no verb in the original in this first phrase. And it's interesting that right after the gifts are given, here it speaks about love. If one would reflect in the letter to the Corinthians, it's really the same format. In 1 Corinthians 12, it deals with the gifts. And then in 1 Corinthians 13, you have the love chapter. And so it's simply saying that those gifts that are mentioned must be used in love. So this is sort of the center of these verses, because it does not, like I said, have a verb. The love without hypocrisy. And hypocrisy is something that is defined as acting or playing. The hypocrites, for instance, in Jesus' day, the Pharisees would have been called hypocrites. Playing the part wasn't genuine. And so what's being stated here is, as you use the gifts, your love must be genuine and it has to be the source. As you go down, now all of the phrases are actually present participles or continual action. And I think it's simply saying that this block verse, the love without hypocrisy, how does it show itself? Well, it shows itself in a number of ways. Detesting evil and clinging to what is good. Glued to what is good. So one can reflect as you do different activities, are you clinging to the good? Are you glued to the good? Great question to ask. Now, as you look at the other verses, it seems like, and we know verses are not in the original, but these are really well organized. Notice verse 10, show family affection to one another with brotherly love. Now, this is a different Greek word, phileo, not agape. Agape was used in verse 9. This is phileo, or the mutual love. And it's interesting because the next phrase within the verse says, outdoing one another in showing honor. That's interesting. Reminds me of an experience that I once had with another believer, where we owned a trailer. And there was one parking spot that you could have in front of the trailer. There's parking below the trailer park and above. And we were in the Air Force, and we worked the same shift. And as we were coming home one day, different cars, it was pouring rain. And so I thought to myself, you know, my friend that lives with me, I'm going to let him take that parking spot, and I'll park on the bottom, and I'll just run through the rain and get there. So I did. I got out of my car. I ran to the trailer. As I was running to the trailer, I saw my friend running from the upper part. He had the same idea. We arrived at the trailer soaked, both of us, but we understood. We were trying to prefer one another, and I think that is how phileo love works. Verse 11 goes on to say, not lacking diligence, but being fervent. And so we're to boil over with enthusiasm to serve the Lord. So there shouldn't be procrastination if there's something good that a person can do. Then it says, verse 12, rejoice in hope and be patient in affliction. Be persistent in prayer. And again, I think the verse separation here actually is excellent, because the rejoicing in hope when you're facing difficulties, we should have hope. Be patient is the idea that don't try to run away from this affliction, but stay in there is the idea. That's very different to the generation in which we live, the name it and claim it. You want to remove the affliction as fast as possible. That's not how love works. And again, these are definitions of love. We are to stay within that, and then be persistent in prayer. Have the habit of prayer. One of the hardest times to pray is when you're in the middle of affliction, because you're tempted to say, I'm in this affliction because God doesn't listen to me. But this verse is saying, you persist in the affliction that is coming against you. You still have the habit and the persistence in prayer. Even though you might think God is not listening, He truly is. So as you look at this small section of verses, again, the main thought, the love without hypocrisy. How does it show itself? In all of these participles from verse 10 all the way down to verse 12, continual action. This is a part of the life that is directed by love. And we know that the fruit of the Spirit is love. This is what the Holy Spirit wants to produce in the life of a believer.